agencies or through internal collaboration with one level of government. Partnerships allow us to more comprehensively address issues. A particularly challenging or wicked concern is community wellness. Today, we will hear directly from those who have successfully used partnerships to advance work to support community wellness. I'm going to introduce each panel member, and that panel member will provide a quick introduction on their organization and what they've been doing in this area. And at that point in time, we'll have 10 minutes for each panel member to discuss some of their workings, which point in time we'll have questions and answers. So first, I will introduce Mr. Tom Williams, Deputy Minister, GWT Department of Municipal and Community Affairs.
Thank you, Dennis. It's a pleasure being here this afternoon. I'm Tom Williams. I was born and raised in the Northwest Territories, and I lived in about 7 or 8 different communities across up and down the valley. I think we moved here in Yellowknife in 1975. And prior to that, I lived in Inuvik, Iqaluit, Fort Gray, Fort Simpson, Hay River. So it's the role that I play, or the department plays in community wellness, is we work in partnership with the social envelope departments. You know, our areas, we promote healthy and active living. So physical activity is important for the youth and for all residents of the NWT. Having a healthy mind and a healthy body, it helps good community wellness throughout the territory. So I look forward to sharing my story with you on a partnership that we achieved on enhancing one of our existing programs. So thank you.
Excellent. Thanks, Tom. And next to Tom is Ms. Debbie DeLancey, the Deputy Minister of the GWT Department of Health and Social Services.
Thanks, Dennis. And again, thanks to IPAC for organizing this. We wanted to start by talking a little bit about why each of our departments and organizations values community wellness. And, you know, I would start by saying it's an oft-quoted remark that we don't have a health system in Canada. We really have an acute care system that treats sickness. And I think the same could be said for our social services system. Most of the people we engage with are people who aren't healthy in the broadest sense of the word. So physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually. And we know that, you know, quite apart from the fact that healthy people and healthy communities are necessary to achieve the goals that community governments have, that our government has, from a health and social services perspective, we also know that ultimately the only way we're going to bend that increasing cost curve is to keep people from needing our services. But again, we spend all our time and energy treating people, so we need to work with partners to get in at that upstream intervention. No one government department can do that, so, you know, and as Tom said, we do work within the GWT. We try to take a whole of government approach, but we need more than GWT at the table. I think that would be true in any jurisdiction. If you're focusing on community wellness, you can't do it without communities. It's especially true in the north, where we have a 50% indigenous population, a population that faces unique challenges in terms of population health disparities. It's just a matter of fact that population health outcomes on many indicators are worse among indigenous people in the Northwest Territories. And we know much of that is rooted in the history of what we call the indigenous social determinants of health. So a history of colonization, residential schools, rapid social change. And why this is important is it really means that we can't be developing solutions in office buildings. The wisdom is in the communities. That's a term I learned from my colleague Sabrina Broadhead. And we need to partner at all levels of government to be successful. And I have to throw out a quote. If anybody watched the National last night, and you may have seen a panel on Attawapiskat, Joseph Boyden, I think, summed it up when he said, "The true medicine that can fix almost everything, it's all right there on the land." So we need to tap into that medicine if we're going to achieve well communities.
Thanks, Debbie. And on the other side of Tom is Ms. Sara Brown, the Executive Director of the Association of Communities.
Thanks very much. I really appreciate being here and having this opportunity to speak with all of you. I belong to the NWT Association of Communities, And we represent all 33 communities in the Northwest Territory. So as you know, that's a very broad range of types of communities and sizes of communities, and they all have different dynamics. But they all come together to work and advocate and do things together through our association. Certainly, it's pretty self-evident why we support healthy communities. And I'm going to be very excited to tell you about some of the projects that we have where we've done that. As Debbie mentioned, we have limited resources. We have limited people resources, even dollars aside. And we're a small group, but if we don't work together, we're never going to achieve the things we hope to do. And that's sort of our approach on all of the projects we work on. So we'll be very pleased later today to share those with you.
Thanks, Sarah. And last but definitely not least, Ms. Judy Kanes. She is the Director of Prevention Services with the Workers' Safety and Compensation Commission.
Thank you. Happy to be here as well. So the Workers' Safety and Compensation Commission, we play a sort of a different role in that we go into all the communities, we travel throughout the territories, and we have two sides to our house. One is the claims, so that's after something has happened, specifically to employer or to workers and that. And then the other side is the prevention, and that's where we really work hard at forming partnerships with different organizations to prevent, because if we can prevent the injuries or accidents from happening, it makes for a safer and healthier workplace. So we've really expanded for those that everybody knows, I'm sure you heard me yelling, screaming and dancing with our new regulations that were passed last year with the title of a change to occupational health and safety. So we're really focusing on not just the safety side of it, but the health side of it, and making sure that we have healthy and safe workplaces for everybody.
Thanks, Judy. So what's going to happen at this point in time is they're each individual is going to talk for 10 minutes. I've asked that all questions be to wait until the very end of the fourth presentation. Some of the things that they're going to go over is how their organization uses partnerships to achieve success in achieving community wellness. They'll talk about the benefits, the challenges, and they'll summarize some of the lessons learned from past engagements and possibly something that they're going to look at for future engagements. So at that point in time, I'm going to start at the other end of the table, and I'll start with Debbie DeLancey.
Just trying to see if I was paying attention. Okay, so 10 minutes is a challenge. This is a big issue for us. We get very excited. Our department and our system, because of course we work with 8 health and social services authorities in the regions, use partnerships at a number of levels. And just a few examples, I mean, we work at a pan-Canadian level. We work with pan-Canadian organizations. I think you may hear a little bit about some projects that are funded by the Canadian Partnership Against Cancer today through some of our partnerships that are speaking here. Within GNWT, of course, we've already mentioned working interdepartmentally in our Healthy Choices framework, which brings together a number of departments to focus on prevention and promotion activities. We have active partnerships with a number of NGOs where we do more than fund them, but one example would be the Foster Family Coalition, where we say, you're the experts, we'll provide the funding, we'll identify shared objectives, you guys go out and make it happen. A number of partnerships with Aboriginal governments. So one example would be at the Beaufort Delta Health and Social Services Authority actually works with the Inuvialuit Regional Corporation in a very formal wellness steering committee where they set shared objectives, they set a work plan for the year, and their staff work together to implement some programs with funding from both parties on the table. I'm going to leave it to Sara to speak to how we work with community governments, because I think that may come up in some of what you speak to. What I thought I'd do is just focus on one specific example of a partnership, and then, as Dennis said, just talk to some of the lessons learned, what we see as benefits and challenges. And I'm going to speak to a new project. It's an on-the-land funding collaborative. I chose this one because it really brings in a broader range of partners than is in the case in most of our experiences. So as I started off by setting the stage, we have a real interest in supporting and promoting on-the-land activities.
There's a great body of academic research. There's wisdom from the communities. There were findings from the Minister's Forum on addictions and community wellness, all which point to the fact that in the Northland and in Indigenous communities, the land has an essential role to play in community wellness and healing. So we have some programs specifically targeted to go out to regions to work with Aboriginal governments to support on the land healing programs, but there is never enough funding. The demand far outstrips the funding that we can provide or any government department can provide. And so in looking to say, how do we grow that pot in an era of fiscal restraint, we wondered if there was potential to partner with the philanthropic sector and with industry. So two years ago, June, we initiated some early discussions with Tides Canada, which is an NGO that is very committed to supporting on the land activities as well. They had an interest in streamlining. They had some frustration that they were getting, for example, 5, 6, 7 requests to support on the land projects in the same community and region from different organizations that weren't aware that others in their community were trying to promote the same thing. So we both saw a potential here to achieve our objectives by working together. What Tides also brought is experience nationally and internationally in a number of different kinds of social finance mechanisms. So different ways to lever funding for common purposes and objectives. And we worked with them about 18 months ago to have a workshop where we brought together organizations, GNWT and other organizations in the NWT with an interest in funding on the land programming. And then Tides brought in some resource people from other parts of Canada and elsewhere who had some experience in putting together these funding collaboratives. And out of that workshop, we developed a concept. The concept was that some of the diamond mines, some philanthropic organizations, and some government departments would come together, would all put some money in a pot, and somehow we would find a way to develop criteria that we were all comfortable with that would allow this funding to be made available for community-based applications for on-the-land activities. We had a team, a working group that went out and engaged with Indigenous governments and communities, and it took over a year, but we finally came up with enough of a structure to roll out a pilot. So last November, the first call for funding proposals went out, and there were, I think, we had over 200 applications totaling $10 million to tap into a funding pot that was just under $400,000, which is what we were able to get from all the partner contributions for the first year. There was a review process, and I'm just going to outline who the partners are because I think it's really significant who we have at the table. We have a panel of community advisors that includes representatives from 9 Aboriginal governments. And then the funding partners include our department, as well as Environment and Natural Resources from the GNWT, Tides Canada, the NWT Recreation and Parks Association, Dominion Diamond Ekati Corporation, and Diavik Diamond Mines, as well as 2 other philanthropic organizations that put some money on the table. So they went through a process of reviewing, and I think were able to fund 26 projects, rolled out all the money, and this is our pilot year, so we're really interested to learn how this goes. I really like the idea of bringing together not just levels of government, but also industry, philanthropic organization, because we often tend to set up situations where people have to go to several organizations and there's a lot of administrative work involved in trying to access funding for one community-based project. So not only does this allow us all to lever funding, but it also provides a one-window streamlined approach for community-based organizations. So what are some of the benefits and challenges? Well, the benefits of working in partnership, I think, are pretty clear. It allows us to lever funding. We should be able to achieve economies of scale, reduce duplication, and also avoid working at cross purposes so that if we have 2 organizations with similar funding programs, but then different eligibility criteria, that's going to create a problem for an applicant. It certainly allows government to tap into expertise that we don't have, which is especially critical when you're working in an environment like the NWT with so many cultures and so many languages and so many differences among communities and regions. It also gives us the opportunity to build capacity in organizations when we're working in partnership. In terms of challenges, I think there are challenges working with any partner. One that's really hard for government is loss of control. We're risk averse. We like to control everything, and in order to enter into a partnership, you need to give some of that up. It often takes more time to design a program approach or to design eligibility criteria, especially at the front end. And then I'd say we've learned that working in partnership with Indigenous organizations, and particularly the Aboriginal governments in the NWT, brings some specific challenges for government. First and foremost is overcoming an inherent lack of trust, which is not surprising given the, you know, relationship between Indigenous groups and governments for many years. A historic lack of trust in the GNWT as a legitimate government, which is simply a historical fact, and we have to deal with that. We need to be mindful of evolving jurisdictions. So in some cases, especially for health and social services, we're delivering programs where Aboriginal governments are going to be able to draw down jurisdiction, and we're going to have to look at how we transition and work in partnership. There are very different expectations in terms of credentialization. Again, particularly with health and social services programs, perceptions of the Western model versus the traditional model, and you know, every partner has to find some way to give to reach some common ground there. I can see Dennis looking at me because my 10 minutes is up. I guess the last one specific to the On the Land Funding Collaborative, another specific challenge would be it's really, really hard for government to be flexible in how we roll out funding, and figuring out a mechanism where we could take $100,000 and put it in a common pot has taken some creativity. Other governments have done it, and we're learning how to do it, but it hasn't been easy. And I guess the final lesson learned I would share again is just be realistic about the time and energy it takes to build something new. You can have a great idea, and everybody can agree on the idea, but then actually getting to implementation can be a very time-consuming and sometimes frustrating process, but it's worth it.
Excellent. Thanks, Debbie. I wasn't even worried about the time, but I appreciate you doing that. So I'm going to pass it off to Tom.
Thank you, Dennis. Well, I'm pleased to be here today to share a story on a partnership MACA has undertaken with both corporate Canada and the federal government to assist in supporting fiscal activity and community wellness. Improving the lives of residents is a high priority of the GNWT, and one of our goals in MACA is to foster healthy families through development of a NWT sports, recreation, and physical activity policy, which will help all residents improve health and fitness. Having a healthy mind and a healthy body contributes to strong community wellness throughout the territory. We're all well aware of all the benefits of physical activity and the healthy lifestyles and how it has an impact on healthy people with less prone to diabetes and obesity and other health related issues. There's reduced youth crime, better results in education. In tough financial times, it's extremely important to leverage new monies to create new programs or to reinvest into existing programs. I wish to share a story with you on how MACA was able to leverage new monies to enhance our after-school physical activity program. The partnership started in 2015. Minister Robert C. McLeod and I were attending NWT Days in Ottawa, and we had the opportunity to meet with the former Minister of Sport, Paul Gosel. Minister Gosel invited us to a promotional event sponsored by Canadian Tire, and they were celebrating their 1 millionth participant in the Jumpstart program. Minister McLeod and I accepted the invitation and were able to meet and speak to a couple of senior executives from Canadian Tire. In our discussions, the topic of programming for youth came up, and we shared information on our programs we offer here in the NWT. And I was aware that Canadian Tire had previously launched and after-school program to promote physical activity for youth. I noted that we have a similar program we offered in the NWT, our after-school physical activity program, that's offered in all 50 schools in the NWT. I also noted that in both of our programs, we were trying to accomplish the same things, the goal of to increase physical activity amongst our youth. The after-school physical activity program in NWT provides funding to schools and community-based organizations to build on existing programs or create new physical activities for all school-age children and youth during the after-school time period, with a strong focus on engaging currently inactive or underactive youth. Projects funded across the territory include a broad range of activities, including cross-country skiing, snowshoeing, Nordic walking, hip-hop, floor hockey, and badminton. In some cases, the funding is being provided for much-needed equipment, such as soccer and basketballs, to set up fitness centers with cardio and weight machines, or to provide students with a healthy snack to fuel their play. So after initial discussions, after this initial engagement, we had a number of follow-up discussions with Canadian Tire and how can we partner in enhancing our current program that we offer here in the NWT. At the same time, we were involved in discussions with the Public Health Agency of Canada, and we asked if they were interested in joining our partnership and provide funding to support an evaluation process of our after-school physical activity program. In discussions with Canadian Tire, we were both very interested in measuring results of this reinvestment, and we wanted to understand what is their return on investment. Something that in a lot of cases in evaluation it's missed when you develop a new program or looking at enhancing existing programs. We were making a difference on changing behaviors and increasing physical activity rates. Was this happening with this reinvestment? So there's a lot of questions that we were asking ourselves and need some answers. We needed to prove that a healthy mind and a healthy body has a direct impact on improving community wellness. Keep the story short, the Public Health Agency of Canada agreed to enter into a funding agreement with us to fund an evaluation of our existing program. And this evaluation, I'm pleased to report, is taking place this year in all the schools in the NWT. We needed to work with other agencies to get buy-in into this reinvestment into our existing program. It included working with the NWT Teachers Association, who's the union for the teachers in the Northwest Territories, and of course our partners in education, cultural, and employment. Both thought it was an excellent opportunity and fully supported this initiative. Now we'll get to the deal. What was the deal that we were provided with? Canadian Tire agreed to contribute $225,000 over 3 years. This funding would be used in providing sporting equipment to our 50 schools in NWT, which involves two intakes, one in the fall and one in the winter. This past January, sporting equipment was delivered to all 50 schools across the NWT. In addition, the toolkit was created, which includes activity programs and capacity building for the volunteer teachers, and bringing role models into the schools to promote the benefits of physical activity. With the Rio Olympics happening, there will be a number of Olympians coming to their schools in the NWT in the next fall. The Public Health Agency provided funding up to $50,000 to support undertaking of the evaluation of the after-school physical activity program to measure the direct impacts of investing in physical activity and changing behaviors of youth. And which we hope the results of this will entice Canadian Tire to extend their commitment to the GNWT over beyond three years. In closing, I want to thank IPAC for inviting me to share this story on partnerships in the area of improving community wellness in the NWT. And I'll take some questions later.
Excellent. Thanks, Tom. And now I'll pass it over to Sara.
Thanks very much. I'm going to talk about a couple of partnerships. I think just want to highlight, though, one of the things that I sort of alluded to in the introductory comments was that there are opportunities to build on each other's strengths and things that we all do really well and really effectively. We don't need to redo them as we approach a problem, and it's good to split up the work as well. So I'm going to talk about a couple of examples. One, actually, we're happy to acknowledge last year at our AGM with MACA as it relates to community wellness, in that MACA became aware of funding that was available for AEDs, and it's 100% funded, including delivery, which is huge, but it was not getting any traction. So we met as a group, MACA called the meeting, and we kind of blew the Heart and Stroke Foundation out of the water, and then that we all came in and said, okay, let's split it all up, let's do it, let's go. Boom, we're out of here. They thought we were going to chatter about it for a day, and they're like, nope, got an hour, let's go. And it was really great because the fire chiefs, for example, they spec'd the AEDs, which everybody having the same AEDs is actually really effective, because when it comes time to replace the pads or batteries, we can do that as a group as well. We have a communal purchasing program as well through the association. As I mentioned, the Heart and Stroke Foundation funded the units. MACA helped facilitate the training by tacking it onto other training they were offering, and then also all of the fire chiefs will be trained as trainers. Again, coming down for a conference here, they will leave with that skill set that they can take back to their community, which is particularly critical given the amount of turnover we have in the communities. The NWTAC actually contacted every community and completed their application forms for them, and got signatures and processed them all and made it happen. So we got AEDs. Some communities already had them, a few did, but there are now AEDs in 33 communities. All 33 communities have the AEDs in, mainly in their rec facilities. So again, that was everybody pitching it together. With health and social services, we've been doing more and more together. We helped facilitate travel with the recent Weaving Our Wisdom conference and the anti-poverty conference as well. We're a little have a little better dexterity than, for want of a better word, than the GNWT to manage the challenges we have around late registrations and decisions about who's attending and all that sort of thing, and getting them their travel funds, because that is critical for lots of people traveling in the north, that they get looked after, or they simply don't have the funds to participate. So we were happy to help facilitate that. We also just worked on a project helping to support healthy living fairs in 18 of the NWT communities. And these are great fairs, very well attended, very popular, in that we helped make sure that the communities got their funding to offer the fair. And then we also went and purchased and had distributed all the prizes to that are important attractants to getting people to come out. So Fort McPherson tents and slow cookers and immersion blenders and all those fun things to encourage healthy eating as prizes for, and healthy living as prizes for the fair. So we're happy to do that. But we're actually embarking on what I believe is our biggest project with them, and I think probably have the really important outcomes for all of us, is what we call our Power Up project. And we're just getting started, but the analogy that was used is that when they realized hundreds of years ago that we were having issues around disease being spread by water and lack of sanitation, the solution came at a community level. It's the prevention that Debbie was talking about, as opposed to dealing with the disease itself. So, you know, if we can get those changes that Tom was referring to and Debbie were referring to, and they're actually 99% of the time being delivered at a community level. So, you know, and in the case of the waterborne disease, the solutions was in water treatment and sewage treatment, which is being delivered by communities. And sometimes we can forget how important that piece is. So we've certainly, based on that, we're looking at what things can community governments do to help those outcomes. And we're doing it in five main theme areas. It's around healthy eating, physical activity and built environment, alcohol, tobacco, and mental health. So what at a community level can communities really do? And so part of our project is to look at those tools we can deliver and to really define where communities saw that going. We went to a number of sources. We first of all did a complete survey of the SAOs in all the communities. We also went back to the wellness plans that all the communities developed and looked at, are there tools that we can do to help them achieve some of those goals that are in there? And we even went back to the strategic plans that all the communities had to complete in 2013 in order to continue to get their gas tax funds. So those were great resources of where communities saw their solution. And I think that was a great quote about the solutions are in the communities. It's just sometimes not knowing how to get started or where the tools are, finding the time. You may want to do a healthy eating policy for all your events, but to go and do the research is an important, and ends up on everybody's important pile, but doesn't necessarily get to their urgent pile. So we're going to be developing lots of tools to allow communities to embrace some of those things. So things in the healthy eating, like a draft healthy events policy, a draft daycare eating policy, so that you can just take it and tweak it and massage it. And the built environment, how to integrate more trails and things that encourage people to be walking as opposed to driving. And it's been interesting when we discuss it on a national level too, because we have to explain how it's different for the North. First of all, there's lots of stuff out there if you're the city of Vancouver and you're resourced to the nines and you've got planning staff. I think we have one community with planning staff, all of the NWT. So how can we resource it and make it as easy as possible to embrace these things? So we're really, really excited about that. We think it's an interesting marriage because we will end up working with MACA on a lot of the rec side, but we're working with health on determinants, and we're working with health on, you know, working with their dietitians to design that healthy eating plan. But we have an understanding of what community or events are like, and we have the ability to go and consult with communities on that. So it's a really interesting way of bringing it all together. And really that knowledge of the users is really critical to getting that messaging out there and making the product that you end up delivering be relevant. And again, why reinvent the wheel? Those resources, those connections are already there. So it's a really exciting project. We're very excited about it, and we're having discussions about where we go next with it because we think there's lots of opportunities there. Thanks for the opportunity.
Excellent. Thank you, sir. And I'll give it to Judy.
Thank you. Lots of good stuff. I've been busy making notes myself. I have a bunch of questions for you. So partnerships are really what we're all about in a big way. You know, our goal is to eliminate workplace injuries and illness. And obviously, as an organization, we can't do it alone. And so we look for partnerships and how can we build on that and how can we assist organizations, whether they're private industry or whether they're government, to achieve, because all of us as workers, we all have that same goal. And so how can we, through partnerships, achieve the goal? So some of the ways that we help in and some of the partnerships that we've created is through training and education. And for some that may know, we used to do a lot of training here throughout the territory. For the last few years, we've moved away from that training, and we now have partners that do that for us, or we work with them on developing the material that's needed out in the communities. So it's definitely had some of its challenges. I would be crazy to say it's been perfect, but at the same time, it really has allowed us to focus back on helping industries and businesses to grow their internal responsibility system on safety, and to focus on just what type of education and training and who best can we match up. So a lot of times what we're doing is matching up with identifying
what type of needs an employer needs with what is out there, and being able to marry the two together, and we've had some pretty good luck with it. So, and really trying for us to focus on being proactive as opposed to reactive, because to come in and help you or help an employer after somebody's been hurt or died on the job is, to me, a failure on all of our parts. So we want to get in there, we want to avoid that, and really, you know, my goal is to work myself out of a job, because if all workplaces are safe and everybody's doing well, I can do my nails or something. So anyway, it's again through partnerships of doing that, working with employers, working with especially communities, because, you know, a lot of times they don't have the resources, or it seems overwhelming, you know, when you talk about OH&S legislation, well, where do I start? You know, the book is 300 and some odd pages long, and you look at it and you think, oh, another day job, you know. So we help to simplify it and keep it simple and make it baby steps so that we can, so that they can achieve it. And that our big, some of our challenges with partnerships is really, you know, tying people. And I really liked what you had to say about control. Sometimes for me, being a control freak, giving up that control and being able to allow, you know, putting things together and then allowing the partners to develop and grow it. And it may not always be exactly the way I think or the way our organization, but that's the beauty of a partnership. So, and sometimes it's looking at it from different angles, which is great, because then you don't miss things. And I'm a big believer in not reinventing wheels, so why do something that somebody else has already done? So if it's worked successfully in other partnerships, what can we learn from that? Some of the successful things that we've worked on is return to work program, and going out and working with employers and communities and government on how do they bring workers back to work safely and in a timely fashion. It helps to reduce costs, it gets the worker back into where they want to be, need to be, and it reduces a lot of stress throughout the organization. And that is an ongoing program that we have and have partnered with several different organizations on. One of the other things that just this year is sprains, strains, and tears. I'll just put a bit of a plug, that's the number one injury in most work in workplaces across Canada, never mind the territories. So we've worked on campaigns with different organizations and looking at their workplaces just to take another look at it to see what is it, is there some commonalities amongst injuries, and doing some analysis and helping employers and that. And then again, hooking them up with the right partner that can help them. You know, if it's a lifting, you know, is there some physio or ergonomics that we can help them with? So those are some of the different types of partnerships we've worked with. One that we've just started working on, and I'm pretty excited about it, but it's working with community governments and MACA, the fire chiefs, and Office of the Fire Marshal, on just looking on how can we get safety training into the local community levels. And we're actually going to be presenting at the Fire Chiefs Conference in June, a workshop that then they can take back to their communities. So, because as you said, some of the challenges with turnover in there, you know, we go in and we help them and they build a program, but the minute the SAO leaves, the program leaves too. So that's some common themes I think we have from all of us. So it's trying to figure out how do we build it into the culture and that. And again, that's through partnerships with the communities, with government, with all vested parties for commonalities. So so those are some of the common partners that we have. Training education really is a big one for us, and we're forever looking for different partners to pair with. I was over, Skills Canada is one of our partners, and I was over there at the competition yesterday and, you know, talking to some of the apprenticeships. And, you know, one of the biggest challenges for us is getting safety so it's not an add-on to your work. Safety is part of your job. And, you know, if you think of riding a bicycle, you didn't learn to ride the bicycle and then learn to do it safely. You learn to ride the bicycle and you learn to put your helmet on and you learn to look both ways and you learn to do it all at once. And that's the way all tasks have to be. And so we're working with our apprenticeships groups to see, you know, so that we make sure that safety isn't just another element that they have to go to a course for. It's part of everything that they do, so it becomes automatic. And some interesting partnerships. Nothing happens as fast as I would like it, so that's always a challenge for me, never mind our organization. Definitely learning patience as we develop partnerships. And I think for me, one of the key goals is communications and making sure everybody's working on the same agenda. We come in with our own little agendas, but somewhere through the formations of the partnerships, you come up with a common agenda to work from. And that really is the strength and the success, I think, of any good partnership, is making sure that, and when you think that, you know, a group has sort of gone off agenda, that we bring them back to the agenda. And it's interesting, we reach outside of the Northwest Territories to groups across Canada, and we work with other regulatory bodies across Canada for common themes, and harmonization is a real big theme. And so I was at a meeting last week where we're looking at partnerships and how we can come up with common harmonizations across Canada, which will be a really unique partnership, because again, everybody is coming in with different agendas. So it's always interesting discussions, but as long as it's on the table, you can talk about it. So that's it for me. Thank you.
Excellent. Thanks, Judy. At this point in time, what I'll do is I'll see if there are any questions from the floor. Excellent.
Probably here towards Debbie, Health and Social Services. Regarding community wellness, I see a lot of people with addictions, and it's often been discussed in the house about treatment centers, and they have their treatment center days where they, that's all they talk about. And so I think there's a pretty good understanding of why it's needed. But I think what I'd like to hear more about is kind of like, what are the challenges of establishing one, and why there is one that in the territories. I know that there's been some people that have talked about the ones that have failed. The one at Calabici and the other one that's up on the Dead Road here. But rather than looking back at those failures, I'm just wondering, what are the challenges moving forward as to why there's
one? Okay, thanks. And so I think, rather than talking about why previous treatment centers have failed, I'll share. We've stepped back and looked, and again, we looked at the recommendations from the Minister's Forum. You have to start with the concept of a continuum of services. There is no single treatment modality that works for everybody who is struggling with addictions. And so we need to make sure that we're providing a range of things that include community-based addictions treatment. So we're now rolling out something called the Matrix program, which is rather than residential treatment, it's a, you know, 24 or 48 day program that people can do in their home communities. We need on the land options, we need mobile healing options, and then we need residential treatment options. So I think when people talk about treatment center, there's this kind of misperception that you can have one building and it will do everything for everybody. And you know, we've really heard that's not the case. So we're trying to make sure that we are addressing all the range of options. The other challenge with having, a couple other challenges with having one facility located in the NWT, it's very difficult with the small client base that we have to come up with the funding that would allow a facility to provide a range of specialized residential treatment services. Right now, we have contracts with four southern institutions, and they all have different specialties. So if you're a woman, if you're a man, if you're indigenous, if you have an alcohol addiction, if you have a drug addiction, you can receive a specialized treatment that has never been offered, and we probably never would be able to afford to offer in the Northwest Territories. The final point I'll make is, we hear frequently, it's just tragic that people from the North have to travel out of the North to receive treatment. The reality is, no matter where we locate a treatment center in the NWT, people from 32 communities still have to travel away from home to go there. And what we heard through extensive stakeholder consultation is, if you're from Illahoctuk, or if you're from Fort Good Hope, going to Hay River, going to Edmonton, really not a lot different. So I think, you know, there are challenges. One of the challenges, it's not just about resources, it's also about using our resources effectively to make sure we can provide that whole continuum. Thanks.
Thanks for that answer, Debbie. Mike, you had a question?
Sure. I guess I'll try to speak up so everybody can hear me. I'm sure what the acoustics are. I guess I have two general observations, if I may, and then one question. I should say, full disclaimer, I'm an employee of the GNWT. These are my views alone. The all-important disclaimer. Community wellness, as some folks have very capably alluded to, covers a whole spectrum of things, right? We've got mental health addictions, we've got eating healthy, we've got being active. There's everything there. I'm all for collaboration and partnerships. And I see value in those, and I understand why they're important. People have to buy into these things. People have to feel like they're involved and have a say. I understand that there's political implications with this, and at that level, there has to be buy-in. But in my respectful opinion, there's some of these issues are better suited to a partnership-like approach to tackle. Healthy eating, physical activity, for example. We know what the issue is. Healthy eating, you know, not to oversimplify it, but if you put 10 well-intentioned people in a room with 10 different interests, they would all generally agree that healthy eating, here are the foods that you need to eat. This is how we combat unhealthy eating. Likewise, with being physically active and exercise and the importance associated with that, get out, everybody would agree, get out and do these things, and you will be physically active and you will be in better physical health. Those ones I see as being easy, and they're just ripe for these partnerships. A lot of the successful ones that you folks have even touched on. Where we get into issues like addictions, homelessness, mental health issues, those are incredibly tricky. Incredibly tricky. If you get the same 10 well-intentioned people in the same room, you very well may come up with 10 different responses as to how to tackle that. It's dramatically different from healthy eating. I understand the value, again, in collaboration, but in my view, what's missing when we're tackling those issues is leadership. Is somebody actually standing up and saying, I'm in charge here, I'm calling the shots. I'm willing to listen to everybody's view, but at the end of the day, this is what we're implementing. We want everybody to get on board with it, and this is where we're going to go. It's leadership, and I think that's really fundamentally what's missing in tackling a lot of these issues. Because again, you get all of these well-intentioned individuals representing a variety of views that come into the room, they sit down, they spit out a bunch of great possible ways forward, but at the end of the day, somebody has to be the leader that says, this is where we're going to go. Again, in my respectful view, the city of Yellowknife and the GNWT, they've got the keys to a 737 jetliner when it comes to legislative authority and the ability to enact programs to tackle this. And I really think that if we're willing to step up and be the leader, in that case, it doesn't mean there's no collaboration. It doesn't mean that other people aren't involved. But that's where these real sticky ones, that's how they're going to get solved. That's my first bit of a rant/observation, if you will. The second being, I haven't read much of the social science with respect to online programs. I understand there's value to those, but you know, I have read the medical science behind addictions. I understand the issues. I understand where medicine is coming from on these topics. So when I hear that online programs are sort of at the forefront of tackling some of these issues, I don't really know how to react to that. When I walk around the streets of Yellowknife and I see people that are obviously suffering from addictions issues, from homelessness, that are just there on the streets, human zombies, if you will, for lack of a better way of putting it, I really struggle with trying to understand how being on the land is even in the top three things that that individual needs. You know, in my mind, it's getting, you know, therapy for the trauma that person's endured, having a house over their head. It's a whole suite of things. So all of that to say, I guess my question is, how are on the land programs, how do they work in the context of medical science as well? Like, how are they dovetailed together so that, sure, you have these programs, but at the same time, you know, therapy, medicine, all the other things that, again, based on my understanding of the medical science, are important to tackle addictions. How does it all work together?
So before I pass that question off to one of our panelists, I'll discuss your rant first, Mike, and I guess the easiest thing I would say is, according to change management, you need a change champion. And what you're looking at is four change champions up here as panelists who have taken various projects or taken various ideas and moved them along. So that person has to keep championing the cause, even if everyone's against them, hence why they're panelists. We've all kind of done that in our own way, but sometimes it also takes a bit of community engagement. Sabrina would know about this. And the community engagement needs to get people on side with what that thought process is. Even if you do not know what you're trying to solve, you need to get them on side so they understand, here are the issues in a smaller sense, and here's what we need to do to start combating that. Is it simple? No. I think every panelist kind of talked about that. Challenges and some of the opportunities that came out of their presentations were both time, training, flexibility, and funding. I have a full list that I wrote down because some of these things are not easier to do when you're confined within the context of government. And if you've noticed that each one of them has talked about partnerships, not just within a specific order of government, they've also gone to private sectors. Corporations can probably do a little bit more with what they have. That is on your first round. And I only know that because not only do I sit in the city chambers, I work for the city of Yellowknife, so I know what some of the issues are at a community level. And we're usually the first point of contact on a lot of these things. So, you know, we have to look at how we would do a partnership on some of those issues. It's a very interesting rant, and I appreciate you for providing it. And onto the question, I could probably provide it to any one of the panelists. I think Debbie's first, and somebody else might want to jump in after that.
Sure, thanks. So on your first point, which wasn't a rant, but perhaps an opinion, I'm not sure I agree that leadership means standing up saying, I'm in charge and I'm calling the shots. You know, to me, leadership is much more about bringing people to a shared understanding of a solution and moving forward. And I hope that's what some of the examples we've been talking about demonstrate. I think the approach you're talking about works if there's one obvious solution, but to those complex looking problems that you outlined, there is no one simple solution. Which kind of leads me to your second question. First of all, you're assuming that when I refer to the research, I'm talking about social science research, and in fact, there is also medical science research that supports the healing benefits, not just for Indigenous people, of being in nature, being in the environment. There is also medical research that supports the notion of the Indigenous social determinants of health and the importance of returning to land and culture as a way of dealing with those. But I hasten to say, you're right, it's not the only solution. It's not the solution for everyone. And when we talk about, I could go on for hours, I didn't have time. When we talk about the role of land-based healing, we actually have designed a kind of a paradigm where if you're dealing with addictions issues, you need programming at three levels. You need programming at the individual and community level. You need, and that's that kind of prevention wellness programming. You need general healing, and then you need access to clinical treatment, the Western medical model. Many individuals will only tap in at one of those three levels. Many individuals need them all. What we're finding is that Aboriginal governments and communities are using on the land programming in many cases to support people to be ready to go for addictions treatment or to provide aftercare. So in and of itself, it's not a solution, but it's an important part of the continuum.
Just one second. Tom, did you want to add?
Sure.
And then I'll get over to you.
Thank you. You know, that was a great question, and you know, everybody has a role to play. You know, the big thing is putting the issue on the table in a room, having a discussion. There's maybe pros and cons of different folks in the room, but everybody has to understand what is the bottom line issue, and to look at in a collaborative approach. How do we? What can we contribute in resolving that issue? I look at our social envelope deputies, the committee, and we have a committee of cabinet we're not pigeonholed anymore. We're not working in silos anymore. Years ago, departments and governments particularly tended to work in silos. I think that has changed and evolved, where we're working in partnership, trying to deal. Everybody has something to contribute to the solution, and including you folks. Including the person on the street. Everybody has to have something to offer, and I think it has to be a collaborative approach to deal with some of these bigger issues. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom, and I had a comment from over here.
Well, I just wanted to add in that on the land programs are, I have a big mouth, but
you're close to the mic.
On the land programs are also really important in terms of prevention. And I'm thinking about youth and connecting youth with their elders, learning about their culture so that they don't end up in the street down here. So we have to think, like I liked your comment about it's an acute care system. So if we're serious about prevention, this is a really important way, I think.
Excellent, thank you. Is there another question? Another question? Oh, in the back.
Speaking of mic. This is all interesting, all the presentations. I'm sorry I missed the first part of the opening, but a lot of the stuff that the panel members talked about had to do with physical health. Very little was paid to, I think, mental health until the questions came up from the audience members. And I don't know about how my fellow audience members are, but when I read the advertisement on this, I thought, you know, dealing with wellness, I know it's a whole rounded thing, but a lot of the focus was on mental wellness. And the gentleman that spoke about, you know, what's the use of the on the land, as a First Nations person, when I'm on the land, it's more than just about physical being, it's also the spiritual aspect. And I think that's one of the key things is the spiritual aspect. I have a sister who's on the street. She's educated, she's finished high school, she's done a lot. But she made a choice a number of years ago to go that route, and that's the route she's living right now. She still has those same capabilities and skills that she learned way back when she was doing fairly well and wasn't on the street. And she very rarely gets an opportunity to use those skills, but she can be a very good contributing member of society, you know? But she makes the choice not to use those. And one of the things that I've observed, I'm a very spiritual person, and when I talk about being spiritual, I'm not talking about religion. There's a distinct difference. I mean, people can be spiritual without being religious. And we need to have that kind of connection, I think. And, you know, when you talk to a lot of the people that are on the streets there, I don't talk to as many, because a lot of times they tend to ask for money. And, you know, that's not what you want to talk to them about. But they do have a certain connection. I mean, when there's a death in the community, for example, there's a gathering of community members, of family members, and what happens? Everybody turns to their higher power for help, for prayers. And so I think that's something that, it's because spirituality is such a it's very hard to define, and so I think any programs or policies that get developed in the government or any approach tends to try to avoid that as much, but I think that's something that needs to be tackled. It's something that needs to be a part of anything that gets put in place in order for it to have any real meaning for people. But I'd love to be able to help my sister, but I also have to set boundaries. You know, there's, and she knows what those boundaries are. And helping people who are healthy to deal with those unhealthy people, I think is just as critical. It's like so much attention is paid to suicide prevention. We had all these discussions about Etowah-Piscet. But what happens with families who have already experienced suicide? What help is there for them? And I think those are some of the things, but the spiritual part I think is very critical to wellness because it's such an important part. And if you look at the medicine wheel, the four parts of a person of the medicine wheel, one part is spirituality. How much attention is being paid to that? There isn't a question, it's as much as an observation.
And I appreciate the observation because it does get into your comments about your sister is a partnership at a smaller level, kind of a family level. And what we're dealing with is kind of the government level and the difficulties. And the moment you get into a bigger organization, that partnerships that you try and develop, they're always a little bit harder. There's always more people involved and trying to move it forward is difficult. So appreciate those comments. Is there another question for the panelists? Oh, so I'm gonna go to someone who hasn't asked a question yet. So go ahead.
I was just wondering on, person who is from NWT Association of Communities, if you could speak a bit more about the role community governments are looking at with alcohol in those kind of five areas we're looking at.
Thank you. We're actually just working on the work plan right now, but there's some obvious things around policies that they can do. For example, can be something as simple as there's no discount for a community group if they're serving alcohol at an event. They can make decisions about alcohol in their facilities. Those sorts of things. You know, they're even within the discussion about Sunday bar openings and things like that, that communities do have the opportunity to engage in that debate on. So we're just going to try to develop tools to help them with that decision making.
Just to add to that, one of the complexities of that situation as well, because from a community government level, is that you have territorial legislation, then you have community governments that also want to do things. Their bylaws don't supersede any legislation that's there, so there's a liquor act as well that provides certain powers. It doesn't provide other powers, so, and that's where the partnership idea comes in and is more difficult, is that you can't override legislation for betterment, but you can start to open up that legislation and look at it, see what amendments could be done. So that's why some of the partnerships, and that's what I appreciated with the presenters, is that it takes longer to get done, and so it seems like there's no action on it, but there is actually probably a lot of action behind the scenes and trying to determine what the best thing is. I appreciate the comments earlier about research as well. I believe I may have had two more questions. One more, Rory.
Thanks. Well, thank you all, first and foremost, I guess, for sharing your experiences. My question relates to the partnerships and more specifically, partnerships within government. We've talked, and you've shared some of your experiences on challenges with partnerships, wresting control, bureaucracy, sometimes it can be difficult. Navigating change and innovation is sometimes an awkward obstacle in order to secure funding and then to realize implementation. Judy, you mentioned aspects of harmonization and bringing people of different mandates and ideals together in order to accomplish something worthwhile. And when we go back to issues like addictions, and we see that it really covers the full gamut of impact on individual and community health and well-being, it obviously then ties in so many different government agencies to be part of the solution. Tom, you mentioned that no longer feel governments are operating in silos anymore, and that there are better partnerships that are occurring. So I'm curious if some of you can share some of the examples from within government departments of being able to actually break down some of those cross-departmental barriers to realize some of those effective goals.
Thank you. There's been a lot of work over the last few years, and Debbie could help me out with this. We both sit on the Social Envelope Deputies Committee, but certainly we had a good review of policy conflicts, like different departments have policies that conflict with each other. So we did an inventory. Where are the issues where policies are conflicting? And how do we resolve those? So that was a big piece of work, and it's ongoing, because departments always worked in silos in the past, and I think we're finding that there are certain policies that affect residents that conflict with each other. There's some housing policies that conflict with income support policies, for example. So we reviewed all those, and we're coming up with some changes to those policies to make them more unified, making sure that they do better reflect what the end result that we want. There's some other, areas where I think we have the integrated case management, where people are falling through the cracks. Say they're released from jail and trying to get services through the government. Well, there was various gaps in policies and programs that we offer as a government. So we put a committee together. I think Justice is the lead on it, working with all the partners and trying to fix those gaps so there is no gap, so people don't fall through the cracks when they're looking for help and services from the government. Maybe Debbie, you could jump in.
Sure, thanks, Tom. So a couple more obvious examples. I mentioned a healthy choices framework. So the social envelope departments and Department of Transportation actually come together to control a pot of funding that's to support prevention and promotion activities. And every year we identify perhaps a priority area, and then each department coordinates their activities. So again, we're not duplicating efforts. We found 3 years ago, the Department of Justice and Department of Health and Social Services independently went and got funding for social media programs to persuade youth not to use drugs and alcohol. Well, that was stupid. So we're trying to avoid those through a coordinated prevention and promotion. One other quick example, the last Legislative Assembly identified early childhood development as a priority, voted quite a bit of money. So the Department of Health and Social Services and Education and Culture and Employment, we actually have come together and developed a joint framework and a joint action plan. And we have a pretty disciplined joint steering committee and working group process so that we're working together to achieve shared objectives efficiently, and we're doing a joint evaluation. So I think you're hopefully going to see more and more of those kind of initiatives, both formal and informal.
Just having a conversation in my head there. One of the things that, when you mentioned harmonization, because last week at this meeting it was a little frustrating at different times, and sort of thought, I really hate that word, because harmonization, it means we all have to walk in the same walk, and you can imagine, because of cultures, backgrounds, and then you bring in politics and everything, it becomes very difficult. But what we came up with was mutual recognition. So sometimes it's a matter of, can we harmonize things? For example, first aid boxes. Every province and territory across Canada has different number of band-aids in their first aid kits, if you can imagine. So if you're an employer or a worker that travels, it's frustrating. Do I have 10? Do I have 12? Do I have 20 band-aids? So something like that we can harmonize, and we can work towards that. But how we deal with mental health in the workplace, that's unique based on cultures, based on resources available. There's all sorts of different things. So harmonization may not work for that, but recognition of the issue and how each jurisdiction or how each partner deals with it, and to be able to marry up the right partners with it. Because how you deal with mental health in Toronto is not going to work here.
So those were the, where we sort of worked through the partnerships of, to get to that. So that a lot of commonalities, but the outcomes are different, and recognizing, are these the things that we can harmonize and we can all walk in the same footsteps on, or are these things that we just mutually recognize? So, and mental health is a huge issue. You know, for us as regulatory body, it's interesting. If you ask any one of our safety officers how to lock out a piece of equipment, they'll tell you 10 ways to Sunday. But to have them go into a workplace and deal with a mental health issue, or deal with harassment or violence in the workplace, or violence that has happened outside of the workplace and come in, it's so far outside of our comfort zone. That so there's a lot of education on our side of the table, and that's where, again, through partnerships, we're learning how best to deal with these things, so that when people call us and ask questions, you don't get that deer in the headlights stare back at you. So thank you for bringing it up, because it is a huge issue within our workforces, and something that we're all trying to figure out. PST is something else that is just coming. I mean, it's always been there. It's not new, but it's just now we're aware of it, and how do we deal with it and not make things worse in trying to make things better. So thanks.
Okay. As much as I love questions, we booked these people till 1:30, so I think what I'll do is I'll wrap up, but I'll give an extra 10 minutes if people want to just ask questions in general, or walk up to one of the presenters and maybe pose a couple questions. But to kind of summarize, our world is getting more and more complex, and as it gets more complex and we come up with new systems and we develop new ways of doing things, that complexity means that how we deal with those situations that arise become more difficult. What we've heard today is about partnerships, and the partnerships have not only been within intergovernmental, so any order of government, it's also been with private enterprise, and some of those partnerships actually get straight down to people in general. What I'd like people to take away is not just the challenges of what we've heard today, but some of the positives, because some of the challenges turned into positives. Time, taking the time to get it done right, ensuring that you have the people and resources there. And we've heard that one of the challenges is human resources, making sure those people know what they're doing, and making sure there's a good cross-training of those people to ensure that when one person leaves, that program can continue to go. We heard a lot about leverage, time, fiscally responsible investments in some of these partnerships, and sometimes that's difficult when you're dealing with orders of government and you're looking at fiscal responsibility for audits and being looked at by other organizations. Various things that came out consistently were communications with both agencies and partnerships, communications with each other, and that's sometimes a difficult thing. And we heard a lot of proactive, not reactive, prevention, not acute care, looking at reduced costs. But the one thing I want to leave you with before I give our presenters their gifts and thank them for spending their time today is, one of the comments came out was on evaluation, and it's often overlooked, but it's sometimes very difficult to do when you're dealing with some form of human interaction. So on health, you know that the evaluation of that, well, do we know that fitness program worked really well? Well, we might not know that for 25 to 30 years. So don't always just look at the evaluation as something that's very simple to implement. Sometimes that too is complex, which adds up to the whole complexity of our environment. So at this point in time, IPAC-NT would like to thank all of our presenters for coming in. We have gifts for each one of you. I won't tell you what it is, because it's more fun that way. The other thing I will tell everyone is that if you want to become more involved, IPAC-NT is always looking for more members. If you want to get involved on the board, please look up our website. It's fairly simple to find. And I'd like to thank all of you for coming out today.
Yeah, no, I'm going to go.
No, no, we have only 4 emails.
Yeah.